Hello everyone. So I'm Rael Khan. Probably know many of you. But for those I don't know, I'm assistant professor in the Department of Psychiatry, and then also have a research position here at the Brain and Creativity Institute, where I've been doing research on meditation and mindfulness for the last 5 years since becoming faculty here at USC. And about a year and a half ago, some of my colleagues who are here now and I started this Center for Mindfulness Science. So the event tonight is a part of our Mindfulness Science keynote series. And thank you all for coming. I think we're in for a good, enlightening discussion and information. Dr. Sarin, Cliff Sarin, is a research scientist at the Center for Mind and Brain at the Mind Institute at the University of California, Davis. He received his PhD in neuroscience from the Albert Einstein College of Medicine. And Dr. Sarin has had a long-standing interest in the effects of contemplative practice on physiology and behavior. In the early 90s, way before it was popular, or even much known, he conducted field research investigating Tibetan Buddhist mind training in the offices of the Office of the H.H. Dalai Lama. He's been a frequent faculty member and one of the real mentors with the Mind and Life Summer Research Institute, and a faculty member at their meetings in the U.S. and Europe, India, and is a former member of the Mind and Life Institute Steering Committee. Because of his very significant work and mentorship within Mind and Life, he was given the inaugural Mind and Life Service Award last year. Dr. Sarin also directs the Shamatha Project, which is how I first came to know Dr. Sarin's work. It is one of the most rigorous and informative studies of mindfulness meditation ever done. We're going to be hearing about some of the results of that very long and intensive study from Dr. Sarin this afternoon. It's essentially a multidisciplinary longitudinal investigation of the effects of intensive meditation on physiological and psychological processes central to well-being. In 2012, Dr. Sarin and his research team were awarded the inaugural Templeton Prize research grant in honor of the H.H. Dalai Lama. His other research area focuses on the sensory processing in children with autism spectrum disorders. So he wanted me to mention that if you have an interest in that, he's certainly interested in a deep way in those questions and research as well, so feel free to engage with him after the talk on that topic. So this kind of research is specifically oriented towards better understanding how these children experience their everyday sensory environments. On a personal level, it's been a great honor and pleasure to get to know Cliff over the last 10 years or so since we met. One of the things that I think you'll all soon be finding out is Cliff is not only a premier researcher in the neurophysiology and psychological impacts of contemplative practice, but also a very nuanced and deep thinker on what it is that we're studying when we do that kind of research. And so I think he will really provide some interesting food for thought and also discussion at the end of his talk. Without further ado, thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that very kind introduction, Rael, and may I live up to it. So I want to begin with a piece of original artwork that is, while it might have been created as a caricature of what we do, it bears an enormous amount of truthiness. Stephen Colbert's wonderful word. So this was actually drawn by the daughter of a participant in our long, big shaman project that Rael just talked about. And so what we have is we have a meditator imagining their different deva realms simultaneously with this idealized body conception of me over here. And we're having our own little EEG deva realm. And what this brings to mind immediately is that the practitioner and the scientist fundamentally embody different views of the world often, and different what we could call social imaginaries. And just to let you know how much EEG was and what we might be able to extract from surface brain electrical potentials, here's a picture of Richie Davidson and myself taken probably in the late 1970s. This is not Photoshop. This is actually cut with the scissors, because we didn't have Photoshop at that time. But we wanted to be seen wearing these very funny, very low number of electrode caps, because this was actually part of, you know, how we self-identify. We were wave watchers, wave reporters, wave interpreters. And I actually showed this picture to the Dalai Lama because the nickname was Hasidic Aliens. So you guys are laughing, but he just gave me a look and said, what? And I said, Jews from outer space. And then he cracked up. So this points up this term, social imaginary, which was put forward by the philosopher Charles Taylor. And what he means by social imaginary is this. I'm thinking of the ways people imagine their social existence, how they fit together with others, how things go on between them and their fellows, the expectations that are normally met, and the deeper normative notions and images that underlie those expectations. And we're probably all members of different social imaginaries, and you probably, without a few moments' hesitation, could come up with different senses of identity that become more online in different contexts in your life, different sets of people, different activities, different communities. The religious scholar David McMahon wrote a wonderful book, The Making of Buddhist Modernism, and has been of late writing articles about science and Buddhism, expands this notion of the social imaginary to go all the way from cosmological beliefs and to your personal goals, and mediated by the social norms and default intuitions that you have that are supported by your large-scale political institutions, physical environment, and structures of society. So with this in mind, we also want to make the point that scientific disciplines have their own social. So there's a fun debate often, or invisibility between psychologists and neuroscientists. So disciplines have social imaginaries too. So these are in tension in the context of research on meditation. So David McMahon goes on to say, the scientific study of contemplative practices neglects the role of culture, historical, social, political, religious, and ethical context. In traditional Buddhist practice, before any contemplative engagement, is a fundamental ethical commitment. This is often not articulated in the promulgation of practices in a secular environment or whatever you might download on your phone. If we isolate these practices from these contexts for the sake of scientific study, we may inevitably distort how they actually work in people's lives. And I want to emphasize here that this does not only refer to practitioners in a religious or faith-based sense. There is always, with any devoted time with expectation, a locally generated context, secular or not, religious or not. We cannot make sense of contemplative practices in isolation from these contexts. They are inextricably, systemically intertwined with them. Since David said these things, this seems ever more true. They are part of a particular life world. Now, we often have the life world brought forth by your iPhone, or your Android, I don't want to leave anyone out, or your flip phone. Because if you have a flip phone, then you definitely have a particular social imagination. So he said these things at the Mind and Life Institute in 2016 in the summer. So here's an interesting example. This is a picture I took in 1992 of an EEG demonstration that we did for the Dalai Lama at a small Mind and Life meeting in basically outside his offices. And the Dalai Lama is really quite geeky if you give him the opportunity. And he's actually asking Francisco Varela here, how do we calibrate the horizontal scanning so we can measure the frequency of the brain waves? And that's why everybody is sort of smiling. And so here's Francisco Varela, intellectual father of the dialogue between Buddhism and science, Charles Taylor, who we were just talking about, and Alan Wallace, who is a Buddhist teacher and practitioner and author who we will be seeing more of later. So on the one hand, we have the Dalai Lama wondering about measuring frequencies. And on the other, we have the Institute of Buddhist Dialectics. This is also 1992. Why are these monks laughing? Because we have put a cap on Francisco's head, and everyone knows the mind is here. So this brings up the issue of cross-cultural understandings of what we're thinking about when we talk about the mind or experience. And this is a chapter that details some of this in this book called Visions of Compassion that characterized one of the Mind and Life meetings. But this picture may actually be a piece of history, because now jump from 1992 to 2018. And here we are with monks courtesy of the Emory Tibet Science Initiative learning about synapses in India in the Drepung Losaling Center for Science and Meditation, which opened last year. So from the webpage of this center, we have what I've said in red, in our yellow, I can't, but that was a self-struck moment. As the burgeoning field of contemplative science provides evidence about the benefits of meditation, interest in the practice of meditation is steadily growing across the world. So, opposing that general statement, we have published a paper last year, which is a critical evaluation of the state of that evidence, which is often weaker and less rigorously determined than the press would lead you to believe, or than is generally felt in international circles, like the motivational reason why the Dalai Lama should be teaching neuroscience to monks. David, who's sitting right here, has this extremely famous graph, which I have been adding to for a number of years, of the number of publications that you can see in PubMed from each year from in terms of mindfulness. And my estimate as of this morning for 2019 is continuing the trend. An exponential increase like this cannot continue. This has to be a bubble. Otherwise, I could walk in this room and not be able to walk 2 feet because I would be flooded with papers about mindfulness. But mindfulness is everywhere. And in fact, we have the new mindfulness. I'm not quite sure what the new mindfulness is as opposed to the old mindfulness. But I want to point out that the new mindfulness costs $14. And there has been a progress. It's not a blonde,
but it's still a white. In a very awkward position. I wouldn't want to sit like this for an hour. Another way mindfulness is everywhere. I don't know if you've ever drilled down into your health app on your iOS device, but if you do, you will find there is a mindfulness tab. And if you then click on the mindfulness tab, you will get an unbelievable number of apps. And of course, in mine, I have no recorded data. But some of these apps may really be of enormous utility for specific individuals. But one of the things that I want to discuss today and to bring to mind is relative to the kind of practice commitments and the things that you have found deeply meaningful in your life. Are screen-mediated apps the pathway of such meaning? Are we looking at a new context in which to consider what this whole enterprise is about? Or are we looking at something that is more problematic? And I suspect that there is not one single answer to this. And there are some very interesting twists that have arisen as apps compete for eyeballs. So in an app called Buddhify, there's actually now something called transmission, which is an interesting use of a term. Now you can teacher-fy your friends. So this is a meditation karaoke app, which allows you, without contemplative training, to read scripts of meditation instructions as karaoke. It actually includes the words on which you should pause. This is an interesting configuration to ask the question, what trace transmission is actually happening, and what theatrics, that is surface, is actually being played out. And it's probably an interesting and ripe topic for research. What is the incidental learning of reading someone else's wise words? I can't say this is horrible, but I can say this is what we should be doing. So this is a recent article in The Conversation. Meditation apps might calm you, but miss the point of Buddhist mindfulness. So thinking about all of this reminded me of something from my youth. How many of you recognize this book? Good, some of you. Do any of you know what this picture is about? This is, the medium is the massage, not message. So this is actually a very famous picture. It's a picture of a man on a rocket sled being accelerated so fast that the pressure of the air has distorted his human features. The medium is the massage. So I'm going to let you listen to Marshall McLuhan describe why the book is titled thusly.
Well, the title, Medium is the Massage.
Can you be a little louder, please?
A teaser, a way of getting attention. There's a wonderful sign hanging on a Toronto junkyard which reads, "Help beautify junkyards. Throw something lovely away today." And this is a very effective way of getting people to notice a lot of things. And so the title is intended to draw attention to the fact that a medium is not something neutral. It does something to people. It takes hold of them, it roughs them up, it massages them, it bumps them around, and as it were, chiropractically. And the general roughing up that any society gets from a medium, especially a new medium, is what is intended to be indicated in that title.
Medium of our time
52 years ago.
To jets, to nuclear energy, is changing everything. We are in the middle of a tremendous clash between the old and the new.
The medium does things to people, and they're always completely unaware of this. They don't really notice the new medium that is wrapping them up. They think of the old medium because the old medium is always the content of the new medium, as movies tend to be the content of TV, and as books used to be the content, novels used to be the content of movies. And so every time a new medium arrives, the old medium is the content, and it is highly observable, highly noticeable. But the real roughing up and massaging is done by the new medium, and it is ignored.
That's a really interesting observation, and it's not one that gets a lot of airplay. So when we think about new mediums and new ways of conceptualizing the teaching of practice and meditation, this is not a new meme. Here's a picture of the Dalai Lama on the cover of New York Magazine from 1998, done up by some photographer to put heart cardiac electrodes on his forehead and cheeks with a kind of not even B-movie background. This looks like some kind of iron lung device. And this is like an old Mac from 1984. But we have this very famous picture from a monk studied in Richard Davidson's laboratory, and that's 2005. And last year we have now it looks like an alien sucking up one's mind through this upgrade to the geodesic sensor net. And so this narrative has emerged, and this is courtesy of Evan Thompson, who's a philosopher and cognitive scientist at the University of British Columbia. If we conceptualize mindfulness as inward-looking awareness and regulation of the individual mind, i.e. a skill, like an attention skill, and we project this conception onto the brain, we endow it with a biological reality. So an individualist conception of the mindful subject is superimposed on a neural substrate. Mm-hmm. And then this whole construct loops back into how we think about ourselves. The received wisdom becomes to be a mindful parent, mindful coworker, mindful soldier. You need to learn how to downregulate your amygdala through mindfulness training. And part of this narrative is supported by, mediums of great social influence, like Scientific American. And these are my friends and colleagues, Mathieu, Antoine, and Richie. And this article from 2014 was almost pulled because of this figure, which has been used in Search Inside Yourself and other corporate mindfulness trainings to indicate what happens in the brain when you do mindfulness mm-hmm. of breathing. And it's a takeoff on a particular paper by Wendy Hasselkamp and Larry Barcelou, but the point is it's misleading in terms of artistic license, the phenomenon practice, interconnections between brain areas, and dynamics of brain activity. We can do a whole talk on what's wrong with this picture, but we're not going to. So there's a bit of some new books out that sort of talk about issues in the evolution of the mindfulness movement. The Mindfulness Elite is a sociological analysis of how mindfulness training was aligned early on with cultural elite institutions, the power of science, academic high-profile elite institutions and corporations. And this is a
sociological study by Jamie Kusinkoff. There's very recently been Ron Purser's book, Mindfulness, which, while controversial and quite snarky in different ways, is pointing out the importance of when you monetize these teachings, and you actually may be constraining the wisdom that is going to be communicated, because people might not like what they hear, in which case your business model will be impacted. There's a very interesting blog by Amon Lely, published just 2 days ago, in defense of mindfulness, which is actually a very thoughtful and balanced response to this book. And finally, we have forthcoming, I think maybe in January or March, I'm not sure, Evan Thompson has written Why I'm Not a Buddhist, a takeoff on Bertrand Russell's Why I'm Not a Christian. So that's the first part I want to talk. I want to talk more now about the research that we've been doing, and that's working with much more intensive meditation than is typical, either under the auspices of an app-based instruction or in non-residential standardized manualized trainings like mindfulness-based stress reduction or 5-week courses like Alan teaches here. And so we have a, if you're interested in the state of the art of mindfulness science right now, I would direct you to a remarkable special issue of Current Opinion in Psychology. There are 57 papers, 57 review papers on all aspects of this field that were published as of late summer. And this is one that we've written, talking about what is filled in the landscape of research by looking at retreat experience. So the overview of the Shamanic Project is where I'm going now. So in 2007, Alan Wallace, you saw him in one of the early pictures with the Dalai Lama, taught 2 3-month-long meditation retreats. They were full-time residential retreats where individuals meditated about 6 hours a day. We had 2 groups of 30. The age range was about 20 to 70. And this was a wait list control design. So think about it. If you're going to join this study and you're able to be part of it, you have to be able to make a 9-month commitment from beginning to end. So we had a first retreat in the spring of 2007, and if you were a control subject, if we randomized you to the waitlist group, you came and were tested 3 times, and then over the summer there was a 3-month break, and then you did a 3-month retreat. The emphasis was on the cultivation of relaxation, attentional stability, and perceptual clarity. The main practice was mindfulness and breathing, but there were also training in the four immeasurables, the Brahma Viharas, loving kindness, compassion, empathetic joy, and equanimity. But underlying all of this was a motivating question which still defines our work to this day. How can we engage with and compassionately respond to our own suffering and the suffering of the world? This is the design in Retreat 1 and Retreat 2. The people in Retreat 2, we flew them to the retreat center 3 times, but they didn't meditate as they were on retreat. They did their daily practice, and the rest of the time between these testings, they're home in this area, and when they're in retreats, they're in the retreat center. We had 98.3% retention across both groups. Only one person dropped out, and that was because of a family medical emergency in Retreat 2. Every one of the control participants made all 3 trips, and we flew people from all over the country, from Europe, from Mexico. And then we did follow-ups. We did follow-ups at 5 months, at 15 months, and believe it or not, 6 to 7 years. greater than 80% retention at each point. This is an incredible team of researchers. One of the great fulfillments of my life is being able to work with a set of colleagues and students and collaborators that is deeply enriched my experience in doing science and my life as a friend and colleague. And none of this is possible without an enormous amount of funding. So this is not a small, this is a on the order of a $5 million project today. So let's go to Red Feather Lakes, Colorado, the Shambhala Mountain Center. Here is the meditation lodge. They had just built this. No one had lived in it. They had a huge mortgage, and they were extremely happy to take our money because the number of facilities in the country where you can have 30-odd solitary bedrooms with a community meditation hall that could be isolated for that period of time is very small. So here now is a grade Alan Wallace teaching in the second retreat. And downstairs from this location, we built two university grade 96 channel EEG laboratories. And here was somebody being hooked up, ready to do a task. And this, you know, there's a phrase in science called a kitchen sink design. This was kind of a showroom of kitchen sinks. We actually had 15 different computer-based tasks looking at memory, self-report questionnaires, computer-based tests of emotion response, emotion, attention, interaction, attention-related tasks, and we also looked at physiology during meditation. So we had many measures, brain activity, autonomic measures, biomarkers, behavioral measures, facial expression measures, which I'm going to show you a bit of, thematic analysis of structured interviews, and self-reports and questionnaire data. But I want to go, we don't have time today to talk about what we've found in all its variegated nature. We've got 15 empirical papers that you can find online, and we're counting with some things under review and some things to come. This is the study that keeps on giving. It's kind of time has stopped for us analytically in many ways. Now the context in which you're meditating at Shambhala Mountain Center includes being able to go inside this great stupa of Dharmakaya that liberates upon seeing, is its title. It's 108 feet high. And if you go through these double glass doors, you can sit in front of this Buddha that bears the relics and skull of Chogyam Trungpa. That is a context. That is not an act. So I want to talk about emotional responses to images of suffering as it relates back to original research question about engaging with suffering. So on the basis of the training intent, we can expect that you're going to be less defensive in response to the perception of suffering. You will expect to show less rejection emotions like contempt, anger, or disgust. What you may see instead is sadness. And I just want to check the time around. So how can we approach this experiment? Well, what we did is we used the paradigm of showing movies to people and unobtrusively videotaping their facial expressions. And this is work that was spearheaded by a world expert at this point of facial expression coding, Erica Rosenberg, and my two graduate students who now are postdoctoral fellows. Brandon just graduated last month. Long tenure as a graduate student. So here I'm going to show you some graphic images that are stills from the movie. These are excerpts from the film Fahrenheit 9/11. I don't know how many of you saw Michael Moore's documentary about the Iraq War. So So what you're going to see on the left is going to be the image from the film, and on the right is the facial expression elicited by that point in the film. So here's a father holding a deeply injured child. Here's a woman suffering from napalm-like burns. Here's a soldier saying, "War is nothing like a video game that they trained for," showing, expressing a lot of remorse and humility. So how do we approach these kinds of facial data? These data here represent 12 seconds of the quantification by hand of every one of the 45 muscle groups of the face using Paul Ekman and Wally Friesen's facial action coding system. We have the muscle group, the degree of contraction, the frame that it started at contracting, the peak contraction, and the end. And then we group these action units together, and there actually is an emotion dictionary where you can look at facial configurations spatiotemporally and come out with an assignation of what emotion people would rate that facial expression as being representative of. You don't need to go through all that to know that this is a picture of sadness and grief, obviously. But if you're going to do this in a rigorous, reportable, scientific manner with maximum objectivity, you deconstruct the face into these spatial units. This coding process took us 150 times real time. So 1 2-minute film clip is a good day's work. You can now do a lot of this automatically with facial recognition software. It still remains to be seen how valid that is compared to the best manual coders. So what do we find? If we look at before, we showed another horrible film to people. Before, it was actually what we analyzed was an excerpt from the film Crash. And before, if we're looking at sadness behaviors, there's no difference in the probability of showing sadness before the retreats, between the control group and the retreat group. And if people showed sadness, they showed it, these are statistical modeled lines, there's no difference in the number of sadness expressions. After the retreat, there is a significant increase in the probability of showing sadness in the retreat group. That is this difference. Zero expressions means you didn't show any sadness. The control group shows significantly more people who don't show sadness expressions. But if they do show sadness expressions, they're the same number. So that's kind of in line with our hypothesis. What about rejection behaviors? This is combining together anger, contempt, and disgust. So actually, even though this looks like a large difference, it's not statistically significant because of the scale that we're at. So before the retreats, the two groups do not differ in their probability of showing a rejection emotion, and they do not differ in the number of rejection expressions. After they also do not differ in the probability of showing rejection emotions. This is not what we expected. But what's interesting is this difference. Retreatants show significantly fewer rejection emotions. Now, you know from your own experience, you still get triggered even if you're a practitioner. But one of the consequences of mindfulness training is that you have this interoceptive capacity to detect the occurrence of that emotional arousal, which can also trigger a whole cascade of reframing the situation. So you can actually find a moment in which anger itself or a moment of contempt is a trigger for your own wisdom. So it's actually not so simple that there's no difference in the probability, because there is a difference in the frequency. Interestingly, we gave people storyboards of film clip and we asked them to rate the frames they could account for emotional changes on. And what we found regarding self-reports and expressed sadness, if you look at self-reports across the films, after the retreat, trainees' sadness expressions were not related to sadness ratings. They were related to ratings of sympathy, not distress and not sadness. So rather than meaning sadness, they measured expressions that we're interpreting with the emotion dictionary as sadness. They actually be manifestations of training-related empathic concern, which suggests a qualitative change in the way participants engage with suffering. There was no relation between sadness expressions and sympathy ratings in the control group. So I'll now talk a little bit about convergent data to still images. It is the case that physiological markers can index enhanced perceptual processing, and cardiac deceleration is one of those markers. And so a phasic decrease in heart rate can be related to increased attention and subjective experiences of compassion during picture view. So again, I'm going to show you some difficult to see images. These are from the International Affective Picture Set. This is the thesis work of Brandon King. So here are some images of suffering, illness, loss, starvation, and injury. Here are some images related to threat. If we look at the physiological orienting, the cardiac deceleration to these images, we can see heart rate slowing. So this is an image that shows the 6-second picture duration, and we have 4 lines, the control group before and after 3 months, and the retreat group before and after 3 months. And there is really no difference between pre and post, and no difference between the groups related to your biological response to threat. And that's actually good, because the last thing you want is to have your meditation training detune your biological capacity to detect imminent danger. If somebody showed you a snake and you said, "Snake." This is not the folks who are going to still be here to talk another day. But now let's look at the responses to suffering. For the control group, before and after a 3-month period, there is no difference between the cardiac deceleration to images of suffering. For the retreat group, there's no difference really between the retreat group and the control group at pre, but at post, there is a massive increase in the decrease of heart rate. That makes the physiological response overlap basically with the response to threat. This suggests that the images of suffering have become more motivationally salient after the retreat. One of the very interesting things that you can do with a 7-year follow-up is you can actually ship notebooks to people with a memory task. They're seeing these images once for 6 seconds, and then jump 7 years later, we're going to give you a memory task. What did you remember? And in fact, people do remember a number of these images. And for threat-related images, this is the physiological response in retreat time. These are all now people who have been in the retreat. There's no control group for this, because the control group saw these images in a different order, but twice. So to avoid thinking about the effects of seeing the images twice, we're looking just at the first retreat group. For people who forgot that given image, that encoding, it doesn't matter where they saw it at the beginning or the end of the retreat, there's much less cardiac deceleration than for those images that were remembered for threat. For suffering, If you forgot them, it doesn't matter whether you forgot them pre or post, it's still a much less of a physiological response. But if you remembered them at pre, you have this acceleratory effect. And if you remember them at post, you have this decelerator effect. And I refer you to the dissertation, hopefully soon to be a publication, of Brandon King, to actually look at the convergent sympathetic measures that we looked at that actually allow you to interpret this as more of a sympathetic arousal in response to the emotional image. And this is a more of a parasympathetic intake after training. So what this suggests is that one of the consequences of increased salience of images of suffering, both over training and in the long term, may reflect a shift in the priority of or capacity for empathic concern. Which links back to our motivating question of engaging with suffering. So briefly, let's just see where I'm going to rifle through some interesting findings that we can talk about. We are interested in markers of cellular aging. And this is in collaboration with Alyssa Heppel and Liz Blackburn and Zhu Lin at UCSF and their colleagues. And you know, your chromosomes have the ends of your chromosomes as a DNA sequence called the telomere. And as your cells divide, the telomere actually gets shorter, because the DNA replication complex binds to the telomere and doesn't replicate it. It's like the bottom of your zipper is not actually teeth all the way down, where the ends of your shoelaces have those plastic caps on them. So as your cells divide, your telomeres get shorter. And this is actually a hard limit on cellular longevity and ultimately neural longevity. However, there is an enzyme, telomerase, which can lengthen the shortening of telomeres. And so in the first retreat, we were able to look at peripheral blood monocytes, and we saw that at the end of 3 months, the retreat group had 30% more telomerase than the control group. This was published in Psych and Immunology. Dr. Jacobs, who was a postdoc on the project, took the lead. But we asked the question, how does this relate to individual differences in psychology? So if we look at the control group, this is change in purpose in life. Purpose in life is defined as the degree to which your past life and behavior and goals are in line with your future life, so that there's a sense of coherence to your world. And what you see is change from pre to post in a sense of purpose in life, and the control group is not related to the level of telomeres. It's strongly related in the case of the retreat group. But I have to draw your attention to the fact that this group of individuals had a decrease in their sense of purpose. And it's interesting to speculate about why going on a 3-month retreat at the end of 3 months might result in a decrease to your sense of purpose. The answer to this may rely buried in our qualitative data. One could imagine that one had expectations of certain kinds of attainments or achievements or the diminution of certain tendencies in one's mind that are not born out 3 months later. Well, if somebody wanted to become a neuroscientist or play a piano at concert level in 3 months, we would say, you can't do that. Why should we think that 3 months represents such an extraordinary increment of training? It's because in this culture, we don't have a contemplative track of expertise. But things that you really are good at take a lot of practice and cultivation. What about telomeres? So we did a study at Spirit Rock Meditation Center. So this is Spirit Rock in West Marin, near Woodacre in Marin County. This is the meditation hall, and these are 1-month-long insight meditation retreats. They're team-taught, People practice 8 to 10 hours a day. You will sit and you walk, and you're about 70 other participants. Here you are in the meditation hall, and it's a very beautiful place. And I took this picture, I think, you know, I did one of these one-month retreats, and I would argue that one of the most impactful parts of participation was hauling myself up from the dorms up to this ridge 7 or 8 times during the retreat. And I don't think it had been since childhood that I had a safe, easy place to come back to that I could do a physically challenging thing without having to camp. This is an extraordinary physical environment as long as you're mindful of ticks. So we set up a way of collecting blood at 5:30 in the morning from participants in a one-month retreat. This is Quinn Conklin, who's the first author of the paper, and we set up a field blood lab. And lo and behold, in a community control group that has done 3 or more, the 5 to 10 day retreats, there is no change across a 3-week interval. But for the retreat group, there is a significant increase in telomere length of your peripheral blood monocytes, your white blood cells. And you don't need statistics to see this. Across, this is ranking telomere length change by individual. And you see in the control group, there is a net zero change. Some people have a decrease, some people have an increase. Can you tell that if you look over here, the whole line is shifted to the right? There are more people with increase, fewer people with decrease. The increases are larger, the decreases are smaller. What's really interesting is that this is not true for everyone. If you statistically model the variability in this data set as a function of baseline personality characteristics, those individuals who came into the retreat high in neuroticism, high in the probability of making mountains out of molehills, they showed biological benefit. People low in neuroticism, no change. Likewise, people low in agreeableness showed biological change. People high in agreeableness, no change. This is the control group. Well, it's really interesting. People high in disagreeableness or low in agreeableness are entering a situation where for a month you don't look anyone in the eye, and you don't talk to anyone, and you don't do email, and you don't text. And so whatever is aggravating about interacting with humans, it's kind of been taken away. Likewise, if you're deeply stressed by traffic, live in LA, you're under constant demand of stress. I guess the I-10 is probably something worthy of study. So you take daily life away, and the body goes, 3 square, I just have to be with my mind. That's a whole other story. So do we know if it's the meditation or the retreat, environment, the whole enchilada of withdrawing from your life for a month? We do not. We do not know what carries the variance. And nor do we know how long it lasts, because we haven't been funded yet to do the follow-up study. But if you want to think about all this, we have one of these review papers where Alyssa Epple has, and Quinn Conklin, colleagues have put this model together, which you can explore in the paper, of how meditation training and mental habits can actually change your cellular biological behavior. All right. So can we have 20 minutes of Q&A, and then so I'll do 5 minutes, and I'll run through this thing, because you're going to actually have a talk by Frank Diaz coming up that relates to this. So Antoine Lutz, John Dunn, and Amishi Jha and I spent 4.5 years writing this paper. So it's, I would refer you to the paper and not this 5-minute light speed précis. But we wanted to create a model that could describe multiple dimensions of cognitive development that are supported by mindfulness training and practice. And we had to make this in terms that would be understandable to practitioners, religious scholars, neuroscientists, and mindfulness teachers. And our model is a heuristic. It's a teaching device. Dare I say, it's not exhaustive, it's provisional, and it's subject to refinement and reconfiguration. So those are the disclaimers. So let's talk about the model. The model is a cube with 3 presumed locally orthogonal dimensions. And we make the assumptions that we're talking about some contemplative practice that has a physical posture, that has a non-aversive stance toward experience, that is being conducted in an ethical framework, and there is some task set or instruction, even that instruction, as Ellen was talking earlier, is simply relax your mind. First dimension, and this is not a value dimension, so that 0 is bad and 1 is good, is simply the degree to which your attention is focused on an object. The second dimension we call de-reification. This is also called decentering or defusion. And this is the understanding that your mental constructions are constructions that do not bear ultimate reality or are not accurate depictions of the nature of reality, so that you understand that your self-talk is an opinion piece, but it is not truth. But it may be true that it's occurred, but the content of it doesn't describe reality completely. Third dimension is meta-awareness, which takes as a starting point being aware. Perhaps your mind has wandered. There are 2 aspects to this. One is a sense of background awareness, so that if you watch a beautiful sunset, you're also able to later on report what it felt like while your visual attention was focused on the colors and the quality and the dynamics and the moment-by-moment changes. And the other is that within that background awareness comes the capacity to detect the presence of a task set. So in background awareness comes the monitoring capacity to actually understand your knowledge. And this space, the state space of the mind we're reading here, has subsidiary qualities, aperture, sense of, is the focus on the candle flame, or are you making the instruction, make mind like sky, wide aperture? What is the sense of mental clarity? You could be on an object, but so dull that you just like don't even have the energy to move off the object. I think experience dullness sometimes when you've meditated. Stability, what is the probability that the next moment finds you in the same place, in the state space? And also, if you're perturbed, how far from the location does the perturbation take you? And finally, a sense of subjective effort. So you can map mental states into this space, like here is addictive craving. Addictive craving has a whole bunch of clarity. It has a lot of stability. Doesn't take much effort to feel craving. There's very high object orientation, but unfortunately low de-reification and low meta-awareness. Rumination has more effort because you're kind of aware you're ruminating, you want to kind of stop it. Mind wandering, very little effort, a low stability. We gave it middling clarity, and not much meta-awareness until you realize your mind wandering, and usually low de-reification. Here, you attention, say meditation, mindfulness of breathing, if the just is on the object of the tactile sensations, a lot of effort, not much stability and clarity in the novice, some dereification, not much meta awareness, some object, high object orientation. The expert shows less effort, more stability and more clarity, and open monitoring meditations, higher in meta awareness for the expert. This model lets us map outcomes of various practices, motivate development of experimental designs, tasks, and reporting relevant to each dimension, visualize the individual trajectories, and identify regions of the state space that might be associated with increased psychological challenge. If you have very low dereification and high meta-awareness, you may have a psychological challenge of depersonalization, because now you're actually very aware of the mechanisms of your mind constructing moment by moment, but you're actually not able to hold those in a spacious way. And to develop contemplative pedagogy based on the model, you're going to be hearing that when Frank Diaz comes here. And of course, to inspire further discussion of what's missing. So that's what I wanted to talk to you about today. So I thank you. Now we have some time, 17 minutes, by the clock, for questions. Alan.
Sure. I'm looking back to your earlier part about Marshall Fleming's novel. So, in that idea of the medium, massage, the medium here, I guess you know, it's just conservation, mindfulness practice, and I think that's a lot for that.
That's not what I'm thinking of as a
medium.
Medium is this.
Yes, yeah, well, I know, but he was saying that the medium takes the content from an earlier time and then says that the medium, it basically buffets the mind around.
So the medium is unconsciously buffeting because you're focused on the content, but you're not actually aware that receiving the content through the new medium.
Right.
Is actually changing the content.
Right.
It's changing the content by deeply perturbing the context that generated the content.
Okay.
And so with respect to the blanket assumption that this is life, that one has a portal and it's attached. And this is global. I mean, I was just in India and the number, I actually had this phone stolen. And the empathy that I got from people when I reported my phone was stolen—it was as if somebody had taken my arm. It was unbelievably profound. We talk about really the importance of understanding common humanity. This now is actually a vehicle for understanding common humanity because people empathize with having yourself as your phone.
But
he
talks about how Buffett's
yes, he's talking about buffets, but that buffeting is not actually articulatable, which is why did I remember this? Because I haven't actually thought about this for like 45, 50 years, since it was like prevalent when I was in high school. And I thought about it because this medium is changing us, and that's the buffet. So I found that clip and I said, oh my God.
That's really interesting. It's a way to frame this whole movement.
Yeah, and it's been sitting there, right? This is on YouTube. Other questions, comments, provocations? Or you just want to share? Yes, you can.
State space, a model that I think is very interesting and useful.
So yet, so this is the question that always comes up. Where is affect in the state space? And the answer to that that I kind of come up with on the cuff, because I think we all have different answers to that question, has to do with when you actually come to know what feeling tone is. So if you're mindful of Vedana, the processes of meta awareness, object orientation, and de-reification are actually in play. So the state space makes no claim about what the quality of the object is. So it should deconstruct what we think of as affect into affect process components. That to the extent you're aware of them, these processes are coming into play. So if we drill down into the task of knowing what you're feeling, these things are going to happen.
So
you can try that on.
In that model, does this feeling live in the world of object? Object orientation, so
we can deconstruct an object into ever finer components, which could be the appearance of, to the mind of a moment, or the little wisp of a sensation that you then get a wisp of interpretation of, I'm feeling anxiety. So it's more like objects can have all of these different qualities like aperture and so forth. So you could imagine ever finer objects, and this is a practical model, because you can drill down and you can say, instant by instant, what is the object?
I guess just my impression is I'm left feeling like it's a limitation of the model.
Sure. and I'm just saying, let me stay inside the model for
right.
a moment, because it's constrained to seven dimensions. In an n-dimensional mind, right? We're not saying, we know the mind, and it's got seven dimensions. No, this is not what we're saying. But I'm saying that if as someone invested in the utility of the model as a thing I communicate about, how would I answer that question? And I would answer it with what I just said. But there is, I think from the point of view of the emotion process or the affect feeling, feeling tone is transient. And it's emotion as a word is a super condensed thing. So unless we really start unpacking what we mean by emotion, which is a whole gigantic field, you can look at the latest The Nature of Emotion handbook that is the 25-year update that was edited by, you know, Alex Shackman and Regina Lapata and Drew Fox that just came out last year. There's a huge terrain of what is emotion.
Yeah.
So that's different than
question.
Yeah.
That maybe will help me get a little bit better sense of what you mean. For a given denotation of those seven dimensions in spot, could it conceivably be any affective tone could be associated with that spot?
Yes.
Or, okay.
Yeah. It is a state space model with undefined temporal and content characteristics.
And in that case, the content includes affect.
Yes. That has been our rationale. Because we couldn't really see where that emotion is a dimension, even though in common parlance it is.
Yeah. So the spot in that model just does not determine affect is part of the answer. Mm-hmm.
So you had a question.
yeah, that looks a little similar, but I was just wondering, so how do you measure
map study, but people should be doing map studies. And qualia is, I mean, you can put any intervention or any state into that kind of a model. That's why we put those other states in there. It's not a meditation-specific model. It's something we got to considering what are the impacts of mindfulness training. And we were constrained because it was for a special issue on mindfulness, but the model became more general purpose. You know, it's like making a widget that is fit for multiple purposes. So one could imagine using the same thing as a framework for looking at apps.
Can you say anything about your qualitative data and what your results from that?
So thank you. It's a very wonderful and a bit of a painful question because that's a pile of very rich data that we have barely begun to analyze. So one of the things that we've done is we've published a paper in Psych Methods by Alex Norman and Jen Picorni and Alex Norman that developed a graph theoretic approach to visualizing narratives using network theory. And you can read that for our general approach. And the question that we looked at in that methods paper was, what are your goals in life, and how do they change across the pre, mid, and post 3-month retreat? But we only analyzed 6 people's data. It's incredibly labor intensive, and Alex has a sabbatical coming up, and he are going to now carry on a full bodied analysis of the larger cohort. But if you know people who have resources and expertise in thematic analysis, be happy to connect because it's very time consuming and very expensive. But we do not know what is in our data at this moment. But I think it's a mother load. So at some point it'll be on the open science framework through some procedure to gain access in the future if we don't get to it. So we have a method, and the 6 subjects indicate an increased commitment to the creation of the conditions to keep meditating, to practice for benefit of others. It's kind of an expected after intensive retreat. But it's not generalizable because I only have 6 people. So that's the status of it. We have a lot of self-report data from validated instruments that's in our papers. Yeah?
One of the things that has come out as a result of that huge increase of mindfulness has been a backlash where people have been writing about dangerous mindfulness, and a little bit of it, people have been doing some talks on this subject. Have you seen any kind of in your data or anything that says that there's really a danger?
We had a clinical psychologist embedded in the 3-month retreat, and a marriage and family therapist in the first retreat, and a clinical psychologist in the second.
But you can see, I guess I'm wondering, in the data, since you're picking up all this stuff,
some individuals had tremendous difficulties, and those difficulties required professional assistance.
I see, okay.
But that's par for retreat experience,
yeah,
with some base incidence rate for the last 40 years.
Okay.
But,
Well, it's kind of in the popular press, to be sure, in the anagram that Morton has been writing about, had articles about the dangers of mindfulness. But it's a
Well, I think that there really are contraindications, particularly with respect to trauma and a history of trauma. There's also a claim that you may not have an explicit history of trauma and you still can get into very strange states of mind. I did a retreat once, and it was July, and I thought I missed my mother's birthday in September. And I kind of was in a waking dream. And with great regret, I went to our house and talked to my mother to give her a birthday card. And she looked at me like, actually, she wasn't home. She didn't look at me. So it was from a phone conversation about it, because I had to explain to her why I left her a card at the door. And then I drove back to Manhattan, and I woke up. And that mindset, after a retreat at IMS, I don't know if you've experienced it. There are things that come alive where the dream world and your fantasy and physical reality, they kind of commingle in a kind of waking dream that is possible. And this is, it was an interesting phone call, because there was a very concerned parent on the phone saying, "Well, have you, what's going on in your head? It's July." But it was really veridical. I mean, it was very, I mean, that's one of my experiences. But I think you can have, you need to figure out how to hold that.
When you talk about contraindications, are you referring specifically to long-term residential retreat experience?
Or so our experience is with those sorts of things, but my understanding from other clinicians who engage in eating meditation, mindfulness of eating practices in a short-term way, that things can be triggered. And one of the things we're going to look at now, Quinn has a parallelogram from Mind and Life to look at early life adversity and these biological changes. So I think that that really has to do with the process of intake at Spirit Rock. There have been questions on the forum, have you ever tried to commit suicide? That's actually, would never be allowed in a university. The IRB would not allow that question. And in and of itself, it's triggering. And, does your therapist know you're here? I mean, there are lots of, this is an a terrain that is not simple.
Questions. So one, just you're probably aware of this, but it's an interesting data point that in some of those early studies of mindfulness-based cognitive therapy for depression, the subgroup that had more early life adversity showed greater benefit from the mindfulness intervention on their kind of long-term reduction in recurrence of depression.
So that is an intervention that you need to be a licensed clinical psychologist to provide, and you're doing it in a clinical context, and you're, there are many factors at play. And so when we talk about MDSR or MDCT, we are bringing a huge set of contextual factors onto the table, and then we can't say mindfulness.
Yes, and that's my second point about mindfulness per se, which is, we, the faculty here at the center, have spoken about, well, how would we like to talk about mindfulness in a, outwardly facing manner, like on our website or that kind of thing. And so I was interested to hear if there is a useful or especially a pithy or in some ways accurate, although that's the trickiest of those terms, that how you might define mindfulness. And if so, what is that definition good for?
That's why we did the cue, to get away from the M word. Jhimpa talks about a Wittgensteinian approach. The meaning of mindfulness is the meaning people use. And if you drill down and you ask 10 people, what do you mean by that? mindfulness, because they're all using it, you'll get to different definitions. And then the meaning of mindfulness is the union of that state. That's not particularly helpful for outward-facing pithy definitions, unless you say it's what people make of it. So, good luck with that. Because I think that what's needed is a super nuanced, or it simply sidestep and say, we care about people's understanding of their lives, of their experience, of what they make, how they make meaning. And let's broaden the playing field so that we're not constrained by this, you know, viral interest in a thing nobody can actually define. Because there are many traditional definitions that don't square with each other. I mean, I like Rupert Gethin's definition of memory, but it isn't memory for what the object was, it's the memory for why you should care about whether you can remember what the object was, which is the whole path. That's not gonna be easily outward facing, but I think it's incredibly pithy.
Quick follow-up on that. One of the thoughts that came to me in attempting to engage in that discussion over time, it's been a discussion we've had, we haven't come to a satisfactory answer for ourselves as a group, but is, you know, the interest in mindfulness may really derive from our interest in our own consciousness, our awareness, the quality of our awareness, that we fundamentally, we human beings, have an interest in the quality of our awareness. And mindfulness is an easy entree into getting people thinking about that. Oh, like, how aware am I? How reactive or judgmental am I? But it's pointing to qualities that qualify something about states of consciousness that are either more salubrious or less.
So that is one view.
Yeah.
I think that there is a wide sense of distress and stress, and people want some way to hold their lives without losing any joy, you know, without losing contact with joy. And the world we live in, and the communication mediums where we know what's happening, you know, the filters that we are subject to that we're not aware of, filters, whether it's the news feed, the Twitter sphere, your Facebook feed. You know, more and more we know that this is manipulated by a whole host of algorithms that are based on your individual behavior. And so we're actually in a self-eating feeding frenzy that we keep losing the awareness that we don't need to be doing what we're compelled to keep doing. So we have a lifestyle in our culture now that is maladaptive and pervasive, and we have a physical reality of the state of the planet that keeps coming in, and with bad news and worse news. And for young people who can project to decades hence, this is war. But we're not talking about it. So how to engage with suffering, to me, is a really central question. And how to have any set of armamentarium to be with each other substantively. And that's not phony. But that's actually coming closer to the real grief that we're pushing against. I don't think it's this fascination with the nature of consciousness. I think it's much more urgent and much more primal. And mindfulness is being presented as a solution. Whether it is or not is a different question, and it may well be at the deepest teaching and practice, but not necessarily in the, you know, in enriching Danny Goleman's book, they talk about the deep path and the shallow path. The shallow path is wide and the deep path is narrow. But I think we need to widen the deep path. On that note,